Fine, guys. So now we would be starting with GST amendments applicable for December 2021 exams. So here, actually, I have prepared a note by keeping the statutory update released by the institute. I have prepared my own notes and I have tried to prepare this note in line with the notes, whatever is already shared with you, which we have already covered in regular classes. Clear? Means whatever notes we have already shared with you, that is regular study material, I have tried to identify wherever the amendments are applicable. You can observe here. I have also mentioned the page number so that you guys can make the changes in the study material only. Clear? So even this note would be shared with you guys tomorrow. Means once we are complete with GST amendments, this notes also will be shared with you. You guys can keep it as a reference. Clear? Yes, sir. Chalo. So whatever amendments has been released by the institute by the way of statutory update, I have covered in the notes. We will do one by one. We will be discussing chapter by chapter. So for the first five chapters, there are no amendments. Yeah, whatever is applicable for the exam, everything we have covered in our regular classes. So straight away, we would be starting with chapter 6. So in chapter 6, some good news also is there. Same way, some bad news. Bad news in the sense, in the form of amendments. Okay, I'm not giving any good or bad news. Our institute is giving. Chalo, or government you can consider, because amendment is the government contribution, not the institute contribution. Chalo guys, first one, chapter 6, input tax credit. So please open your study material and keep it as a reference. So wherever there is any amendment, I will also ask you people to open it with respect to the relevant page numbers. First one, ITC to be availed in respect of invoices or debit notes not uploaded by the suppliers in their GSTR ones, reduced from 10% to 5% of eligible ITC, rule 36.4 amendment. This is an amendment, page number 73. Sir, what is that page number 73 in our regular study material? So come to page number 73 in our regular study material, guys. Chapter 6. So if you do like this now, so I thought it would be helpful for you because you would have already studied from this material. So whatever changes that is there, if you just update it here only, it will be helpful for your studies in one place. Okay, sir. So this is what I'm talking about, guys. Whatever I'm referring now is your regular study material, which you have already covered. Fine, sir. So your 10% is there, na? 10% is there. Sir, what is this provision? See, with respect to whatever GSTR 1 will be filed by the supplier, the recipient can claim credit only with respect to the uploaded invoices. Clear? Sir, what if the supplier has not uploaded the invoices? Can the recipient can claim the credit? Yes, he can claim, but maximum 10% of eligible input tax credit with respect to the uploaded invoices. Agree? That was there, the provision, existing provision. But this 10% is reduced to 5% from 1st January 21. That's all. Previously, it was 10% from 1st January. Sir, should I write that? No, guys, I have covered everything in my amendment notes. You don't write anything. I am just explaining what was the effect before amendment and what will be the effect after amendment. You guys need not write anything. If you want, you can change this 10% to 5% maximum. That's all. Yeah. Yes, sir. Now we will see what is the effect of this. As per the existing rule 36.4, ITC to be availed by the registered person in respect of invoices or debit notes, the details of which have not been uploaded by the supplier in GSTR 1, cannot exceed 10%. This was the existing rule of the eligible credit available in respect of invoices or debit notes, the details of which have been uploaded by the suppliers in GSTR 1. This was the existing provision. But with effect from 1st January 2021, notification number 94/2020, CT dated. Sir, all this notification number, CT dated and all, is it relevant? No. Has amended the said rule to reduce the said percentage from 10% to 5%. I have violated the amendment in red color, guys. Yes. So amendment rule 36.4 is having a what effect? Where the invoice or debit note has been uploaded by the supplier in the GSTR 1 or using the invoice furnishing facility. Sir, what is this invoice furnishing facility? We will see it later. Even that is a new provision. So whatever details or invoices are uploaded by the supplier in GSTR 1 or invoice furnishing facility I can claim full credit provided I am eligible for it. I can claim full credit, no doubt with respect to that. So this is same as my previous provisions. Coming to second part, where the invoice or debit note has not been uploaded by the supplier, in his GSTR 1 or using the invoice furnishing facility IFF, that is, in that case, how much credit I can claim? Whatever credit is available for you with respect to unuploaded invoices, that amount, or 5% of eligible ITC. 5% of what? Whatever ITC you have taken here, 5% of that we will take it. Okay. So 5% of the eligible ITC available in respect of the uploaded invoice or debit notes. However, the ITC so claimed should not exceed the actual eligible ITC available in respect of invoices not uploaded. In simple, with respect to unuploaded invoices, whatever ITC you have, or 5% of eligible ITC with respect to uploaded invoices, whichever is lower. Clear? Yes, sir. So in our regular class also, we have discussed two illustrations after this provision. So for the same problems or illustrations, I have covered the new provision and I have given a solution here. Let me do it. Let us discuss it. So instead of studying the illustration which is given in our regular study material, you guys need to study this re-illustration where I have considered the amendment. Mr. Vijay, a registered supplier, receives 100 invoices for inward supply of goods or services involving GST of 10 lakh. So who is Mr. Vijay? He is a recipient. He has received 100 invoices. So when I am receiving 100 invoices means I am a recipient. Okay, sir. And that 100 invoices includes 10 lakh GST, which I have paid on my inward supply. Fine, sir. From the various suppliers during the month of October 2021. Take it as October 2021. Out of the 100 invoices, 80 invoices involving GST of 6 lakh have been uploaded. Okay. So out of 10 lakh, the invoices with respect to 6 lakh GST is been uploaded. So can I claim full 6 lakh credit? Yes, provided other conditions are satisfied. We are assuming that all other conditions are satisfied. So we can claim 6 lakh credit. Okay, sir. Have been uploaded by the suppliers in their respective GSTR 1 file on the prescribed due date thereafter. Then what about with respect to the balance 4 lakh? We have to calculate by applying the provision. Compute the ITC that can be claimed by Mr. Vijay, who is a recipient, in his GSTR 3B. Any credit can be claimed in GSTR 3B for the month of October 2021. You guys can change it later. I would be sharing this material tomorrow, to be filed by 20th November 2021. So what is the due date to file GSTR 3B? 20th of next month. Yes, sir. Assuming that GST of 10 lakh is otherwise eligible. So otherwise eligible means all other conditions are satisfied. That is 16, 17, all those conditions. So what is the solution? First point, 80 invoices, whatever is uploaded, straight away 6 lakh full I can claim. Any doubt in this? No, sir. We have already covered the same illustration, guys. Same thing with new amendment, I have brought it here. Then coming to 20 invoices, which is not uploaded by the supplier. What is the GST with respect to that 20 invoices? 4 lakh, sir. Now, can I claim 4 lakh full? No, sir. 4 lakh or 5% of 6 lakh. I repeat, 4 lakh or 5% of 6 lakh. Oh, what is 6 lakh? The ITC which you are claiming with respect to uploaded invoices, which comes to 0.3 lakh. 5% of 6 lakh is 0.3 lakh. 0.3 lakh or 4 lakh, whichever is lower is 0.3 lakh. So with respect to unuploaded invoices, you can claim 0.3 lakh. You may ask, sir, what about the balance 3.7 lakh? You can claim it provided the supplier will upload it at least in the next months. So in the next month, coming in November or December, if the supplier is uploading those remaining 20 invoices, you can claim the remaining 3.7 lakh credit. Clear? Yes, sir. I have also given a notes for this. 100% ITC can be availed on the invoices uploaded by the suppliers in their GSTR 1. Yes, sir. Second one, as per rule 36.4, the ITC in respect of invoices not uploaded by the suppliers in the GSTR 1 is restricted to 5% of eligible ITC in respect of invoices not uploaded in GSTR 1, thus in respect of 20 invoices not uploaded, how much GST I can claim? Either 4 lakh or 5% of 6 lakh, whichever is lower, which comes to 0.3 lakh. Any confusions, guys? Hope it is clear for you. Same problem, whatever illustrations we have covered in the class, considering the amendment, I am done it here. Okay, you guys also can go through this later. Then coming to illustration 2, even this illustration we have covered in the class. What is that? Quickly, I will read it. Mr. Ajay, a registered supplier, receives 100 invoices for inward supply of goods or services, involves GST of 10 lakh. Okay, same 100 invoices recipient is receiving, with respect to which the GST is 10 lakh. From various suppliers during the month of October 2021. Out of 100 invoices involving GST of 9.5 lakh have been uploaded by the supplier. Okay, 9.5 lakh straight away I can claim, provided it is eligible. Yes, sir. Balance 0.5 lakh, we need to check it. 9.5 lakh have been uploaded by the suppliers in their respective GSTR filed on the prescribed due date, therefore. Compute the ITC that can be claimed by Mr. Vijay in his GSTR 3B for the month of October to be filed by 20th November, assuming that GST of 10 lakh is otherwise eligible for ITC. So with respect to 85 invoices, whichever has been uploaded, I can claim full GST as a credit. Okay, sir. Coming to 15 invoices, which is not uploaded, what will be the percentage? 0.5% of 9.5 lakh or 0.5 lakh or 0.5 lakh, whichever is lower comes to 0.475. Yeah, so how much you can claim with respect to unuploaded invoices? 0.475. So total credit which I can claim for October is 9.975. Yeah, I have given a notes for with respect to this. You guys can go through this. Clear? Any confusion, guys? Till you? Same illustrations we have covered in the class also, guys. Just a second. See illustration 1 and illustration 2. But here we had taken 10% for the unuploaded part. But here, whatever amendment notes I have prepared, it is with respect to 5%. I have considered 5%, that is the amendment part, and I have solved the illustration. Clear? Shall I proceed? So the next part, very important, good news. Very good news for you guys. That is, two rules has been removed for your November exams. Rule 42 and 43. The complicated rules actually. In the class also, we had took long time to cover this. If they had removed this before only, then I would have also been happy. But they have removed now. I am not so happy. You guys are happy. Okay, because anyhow, we have covered this in the class. So you guys need not study these rules. So what is that? We will see. Manner of determination of input tax credit in respect of input or input services and reversal thereof in respect of input or input services referred to in section 17.1 and 17.2. Sir, what is 17.1 and 17.2? Chalo, get back to our regular material. Come to input tax credit chapter. That is chapter 6 only. Come to this part. So 17.1 and 2, what it covers is, sir, if I have purchased any input or input services for both the purposes, which I will use for both the purposes, business purpose, non-business purpose, they have told that only the input tax credit which is attributable to the business purpose you can claim. Anta, sir, how much is attributable to business purpose? How much is not attributable to business purpose? How can I calculate? Rule 42 was helping you. Clear? Same way. If you have purchased any capital goods, input or input services for providing outward supply, which is taxable as well as exempt, you are providing two supply, one is taxable, one is exempt. In that case, how much ITC I can claim is only the ITC which is attributable to taxable outward supply. Clear? Sir, how much is related or attributable to outward taxable supply? How can I calculate? Same rule 42. Fine. This is with respect to input goods or input services. What about capital goods? Same way, for capital goods, the manner of distribution of credit, if I am using capital goods for both business purpose or non-business purpose, or for providing outward taxable supply or for providing and also providing exempt outward supply, then how do we calculate the credit? It was given in rule 43. Both the rules have been removed off. Yeah, that is what I have covered here. So page number 79 and 81 in your study material. Please come to page number 79 and 81. So you guys can scratch this. Entire full story is there. You guys can scratch this completely. Rule 42, you can scratch completely, which is there in 79 page number in your study material, guys. Chalo, this was with respect to input and input goods. Entire thing, whatever I am scrolling now, entire thing is cancelled. And even rule 43 is cancelled. Clear? Cancel with a happy face, because this was the toughest thing in the input tax credit chapter. Clear? For those who have already studied, your efforts has not gone into vain, because same thing will be covered in your final level. You need not worry. Those who are not studied still, be happy, because you're not studied anta. Chalo guys, get back. So two things is completely removed from our inter syllabus for November or December exams. Chalo, next new rule, important rule guys. So this is not an amendment, completely new provision. Please pay attention. Restriction on use of amount available in electronic credit ledger, rule 86B. As I told you, this is completely a new provision. So nowhere we have covered it in our study material. So what is the effect of this? Sir, what is this? See, normally we have learned, sir, if there is any credit, how we can claim, how you can utilize, everything we have seen. Agree? In input tax credit chapter. Yes, sir. So whenever there is any credit, we can adjust it against our output tax, which I am supposed to pay on my outward supply. Agree? And the manner of utilizing the credit also we have discussed. That is, we have to first utilize the IGST credit fully. Then we have to use CGST and SGST credit in any order. But CGST credit cannot be adjusted against SGST, and SGST credit cannot be adjusted against CGST. These are the rules and regulations which you have already learned. Now, one more new rule they have added. Sir, what is that? Whatever, this is applicable only for some specific people, not for everyone. What is that? We will see. Sir, assume you have an output tax of 10 lakh rupees. Output tax or output GST, I will call it as. That is GST payable on your outward supply. Fine, sir. So there is an input tax. That is the tax which you have paid on your purchases. Assume 12 lakh credit is available with you. So what will you do, guys? When you are filing your GST or 3B, what will you do? Whatever outward tax is there, that is with respect to outward supply, I am liable to pay 10 lakh to the government in the respective month. But will I pay it? No, sir. Because I have a credit of 12 lakh rupees in my electronic credit ledger. Can I utilize it? Yes. Provided you have satisfied all the conditions given under section 16 and 17, you can use it. Assume I have satisfied all the conditions. Can I use it? Yes, sir. So how much I will use? Full 10 lakh. Out of 12 lakh, full 10 lakh I will use. And balance 2 lakh, I will carry forward to the next period. Clear? This is what we have learnt in our regular class. But now, after introduction of rule 36B, what they have told is, whatever you pay to the government can never be nil. It can never be nil. That is, GST to be paid in cash or using electronic cash ledger cannot be zero. What they are telling is, at least 1% of your output tax you have to pay. At least 1% of whatever output tax which you are supposed to pay on your outward supply, you have to pay minimum 1% in cash. That is using electronic cash ledger. That means, what is the indirect meaning of this is, maximum I can use credit to adjust only 99%. Maximum credit which I can use is only 99%. Because I have to pay at least 1% using the cash ledger balance. Clear? As I told you, this is not applicable for everyone. For whom it is applicable, we will see later. But I am just explaining the provision. So after introduction of this provision, what will be the effect? Sir, I have an output GST of 10 lakh rupees. I have a credit of 12 lakh. Can I adjust full? The answer is no. So what you have to do is, at least 1% I have to pay in cash. So how much you have to pay in cash, that is using electronic cash ledger, is 10 lakh into 1%, even though you have a credit. How much is that? 10,000. Yes, sir. So how much credit you can adjust? That is 9,90,000. Okay, sir. Input tax credit, I will adjust 9,90,000. Sir, what about the 2,10,000? Carry forward to the next period. We will call it as unutilized input tax credit. Clear, guys? Yes, sir. This was one example. Let me give one more example. Sir, I have 10 lakh tax liability, that is output GST. But I have only 5 lakh credit, sir. I have only 5 lakh credit. Can I utilize full? Yes, utilize. Because whatever you pay in cash is more than 1%. So in that case, you can utilize full 5 lakh credit and balance 5 lakh, you will pay it in cash. Any doubt in this? What they have told is, whatever you finally pay should be at least 1%. Should be at least 1%. Yeah, come back. So we'll go to one more example. Sir, my output GST is same 10 lakh. I have a credit of 9 lakh. I have a input tax credit of 9 lakh. Can I utilize it? Yes, 9 lakh you can utilize. And you are paying 1 lakh in cash, which is more than 10,000. At least 10,000 you should pay in cash. Clear? Yes, sir. Means whatever you pay should be at least 1% of your outward tax. Clear? Next, we will come to one more example. Sir, I have output tax of 10 lakh. That is outward GST. Fine. And I have a credit of, let me write it here. I have a credit, that is input tax credit available is 9,95,000, sir. I have a credit of 9,95,000. Can I use full? No, sir. Because first you calculate this figure. How much I should minimum pay in cash? 10,000. So how much maximum input tax credit you can use? 9,90,000. Understood. If this is the scenario, first calculate what is the amount we will pay in cash. And the balancing figure will be the input tax credit which you will pay, which you will utilize. Clear? Sir, what about the balance remaining 5,000 credit? Carry forward it to the next month. Clear, guys? So with the different figures, I have explained this provision. Now let us just go through this provision. Easy provision only, but they have kept some new thing. Shalom. There is a new additional condition with respect to credit. And sir, what is the logic? Why they have brought it here is, see, government need to have some regular cash flows for them. Especially during this COVID time and all, they didn't have enough cash balance to run the country. That is why they have added this condition, so that at least 1% I will receive from the suppliers. And that too, not regular suppliers, huge suppliers. Because this provision, as I told you, it is not applicable for everyone. Whoever has the supply worth more than 50 lakh in a month, only for them it is applicable. Chalo, we will understand this. So this is a new rule, guys. With effect from 1st January 2021, a new rule 86B has been inserted in CGST rules to restrict the amount available in the electronic credit ledger which a registered person can use to discharge his output tax liability to 99% of such tax liability in cases where the value of taxable supply other than exempt supply and zero rated supply in a month exceeds 50 lakh. Very important. Sir, for whom it is applicable, first we will learn, because it is not applicable for everyone. Only for those suppliers whose value of supply, excluding exempt supply, excluding zero rated supply, that means only taxable supply. Because see, even zero rated supply is also taxable supply only, but we have to exclude it. Okay, sir. If the value of supply excluding zero rated and exempt supply is more than 50 lakh in a month, not in a year, in a month, if it is more than 50 lakh, then only this provision is applicable. Sir, what if I am a supplier whose turnover is 10,000, 20,000, 10 lakh, 20 lakh, 30 lakh? Is it applicable? This new rule itself is not applicable. This new rule itself is not applicable. Fine, sir. This rule overrides all other rules. So you did not think, sir, in some other rule we learned something else na, in some other section we learned something else na. So order of utilization of credit, we learned that we should do like this, we should do like that. Then what will be the effect of this? This rule will override all other rules. Clear? That means this will be impact, means this will be effective even if there is some other things covered in some other rules or provisions. Yes, sir. It implies that a registered person shall not use the amount available in the electronic credit ledger to discharge his liability towards output tax in excess of 99% of such tax liability in excess, where the value of taxable supply other than the exempt supply and zero rated supply in the month exceeds 50 lakh. 50 lakh. Yes, sir. Example. So we have one example also. What is that? We will see. The total value of interstate supply of Raman and Sons for the month of February is 100 lakh. So can I tell rule 86B is applicable for him? Is rule 86B is applicable? Yes, because the value of supply in the month of February 2021 for Raman and Sons is 100 lakh. And it is February 2021. That is on or after 1st Jan 21 only. Yeah. Yes, sir. Said supply is taxable at 18% IGST. Thus, the total output tax liability of Raman and Sons is 18 lakh. Amount available in electronic credit ledger is 20 lakh. So I have a 20 lakh credit and how much I have a liability? 18 lakh. Sir, can I use full 20 lakh credit? You can maximum use 18 lakh. We know that. Can I use full 18 lakh and pay nothing to the government? No, at least 1% you should pay. In terms of restriction imposed by rule 86B, Raman and Sons can discharge 99% of its output tax liability. So what is the meaning of this? So I can use only 99% of my output tax liability as credit, means at least 1% I should pay in tax. Clear? So that is 17,82,000, 99% of 18 lakh. Sir, what is 18 lakh? Output tax liability. Okay. From the amount available in electronic credit ledger. However, it has to mandatorily discharge the balance 1% of output tax liability, that is 18,000, 1% of 18 lakhs through electronic cash ledger only. That means the tax to be paid in cash is how much? 18,000, which is 1% of my 18 lakh. Clear, guys? Any doubt in this? No, sir. So what is the impact of this is at least 1% of my output tax I need to pay in cash. I need to pay in cash. Clear? Sir, what about the credit? For example, I have already discussed the example, different example possibilities. Sir, my output tax is 10 lakh, but credit available is 8 lakh. Can I use full 8 lakh? You can use it. Don't take 99% of 8 lakh. It will be wrong. 99% is actually on output tax. On output tax. So if I give an example, sir, so same thing. So I think Athira was asking me to show the first instance. So output tax or output GST is 10 lakh. So input available is 12 lakh. So this 1% or 99% thing will come only in a situation where you have credit more than your output GST, guys. In most of the situation, only in those things, this rules comes into picture. Or else if you have a credit less than your output tax, obviously the difference we have to pay in cash, and make sure that the difference what we pay in cash is at least 1% of your output tax. Yeah, any doubt on this? No, sir. So we have discussed the different instances also here. Chalo. This restriction shall not apply to, I told you, sir, the main intention was of bringing this amendment or new rule was because the government should have sufficient cash flow, regular cash flows. Instead of, means if the SSE is using or the supplier is using entire credit, government will not be getting any revenue. Agree? Now, this provision will not apply to few cases. In few cases or for few suppliers. Who are those? We will see one by one. Where the said person or proprietor or karta or managing director or any of its two partners, whole-time director or members of managing committee of association or board of trustees, as the case may be, have paid more than 1 lakh as income tax, not GST, income tax in each of the last two financial years. I repeat, if the supplier or if the supplier is a company, on behalf of company, the managing director, or in case of SSE, or the supplier is a partnership firm, then at least two partners of that firm. Agree? Yes, sir. So in case if the supplier or the registered person is a company, then on behalf of them, we will check for managing director. Fine, sir. So if this supplier asked paid at least more than 1 lakh rupees income tax in the last two previous year, for them, rule 86B is not at all applicable. Clear? Because at least they are paying income tax. Now government is having regular income. So what they can do? They can use full of their credit. No 1%, 99% applicable for them. Okay, sir. Second exclusion. Where the registered person has received a refund of more than 1 lakh in the preceding financial year on account of unutilized ITC in case of zero rated supplies made without payment of tax or inverted duty structure. Sir, when will I get a refund of unutilized credit is in two situations, guys. That is, sir, I am importing some raw material on which I have paid IGST. Now, using that, I am producing some product which I am exporting. Export is a zero rated supply, in which I need not pay any tax. It is a taxable, but rate is zero rated. So in that case, whatever tax I have paid on my purchases, can I claim a refund of that? Yes, sir. If you have claimed more than 1 lakh rupees refund in the preceding financial year, that is in the last year, then for you 86B is not applicable. Okay. Or else inverted duty structure case. What is inverted duty structure case? Sir, whatever tax I have paid on my purchases is more than the tax which I am supposed to pay on my outward supply. I repeat, whatever tax I am paying on my inward supply, which is purchases, is more than the tax which I am supposed to pay on my outward supply. Even in that case, how will I utilize the credit? I have a credit. Will I be able to utilize it? Can I carry forward? No, sir. So in those situations, the unutilized ITC will be refunded back to the SSE or the supplier. So here, if you have got a refund of more than 1 lakh rupees in these two situations in the last year, then for you, rule 86B is not at all applicable. Clear? Yes, sir. Third situation, where the registered person has discharged his liability towards output tax through the electronic cash ledger for an amount which is in excess of 1% of total output tax liability applied cumulatively up to the said month in the current financial year. Sir, what is this? See, this calculation is a cumulative calculation. Let me explain this. Please pay attention. So this provision came from 1st January 2021. Let me take January 21. My output GST. ITC, input tax credit. Tax paid in cash. Cumulative output GST. Cumulative output GST and cumulative GST paid in cash. Okay. Listen, guys, please pay attention. This is important. In January, my output GST was, assume, 1 lakh rupees. Okay, sir. And you add a ITC of 80,000. So how much credit you will use? Full 80,000. Agree? Assume your value of supply is more than 50 lakh in this scenario. Yes, sir. So you would have paid 20,000 in cash by utilizing 80,000 credit. So cumulative output GST at the end of January month is 1 lakh only. Cumulative. How much you have paid till January end? 20,000. Clear? So this is what the data you will give while you are filing GSTR 3B for the month of January within 20th February. Clear? Okay, sir. Now coming to February 21. That is next month. So next month, I have a tax liability of 1,50,000. 1,50,000. Okay, sir. I have a credit of full 1,50,000. 1,50,000. So in that case, tax to be paid in cash is? Tax to be paid in cash is? How much? 1% of 1,50,000 at least I should pay. Agree or else, let me take this as 140, one second. 1,40,000. I have a credit of 1,40,000. So how much I will pay in cash after adjusting 10,000? Sir, is it 1% at least? Yes. It is at least 1% of my 1,50,000. Fine, I am happy. Then come into cumulative output GST. That is 1 lakh plus 1,50,000. You have to add both. 2,50,000. So the by the end of February, my output tax total was 2,50,000. Total GST paid by the end of February is 20,000 plus 10,000, which comes to 30,000. Okay, sir. Now come into March. March 21. I have a output GST of 2,00,000 rupees. Output GST of 2,00,000 rupees. Then I have a ITC of assume 2,00,000. I have a ITC of rupees 2,00,000. So should I pay anything in cash? Obviously, how much? 2,00,000 into 1%. How much it will be? 2,000. At least 2,000 you should pay. But you need not pay it provided. What is the condition? I will tell you guys. See, we know that by after studying rule 86B, we know that at least 1% of 2,00,000 we should pay in cash, which comes to 2,000. But they are telling, if at the end of the month, what is the cumulative output GST? 2,50,000 plus 2,00,000, 4,50,000. Until the end of, if you don't pay anything in March, what is the amount you have already paid? 30,000 in cash. Agree, na? So check whether this is at least 1% of this. So 30,000 divided by 4,50,000 into 100%. More than 1%, how much is that? 6.67, which is more than 1%. Any doubt in this? So that means in that case, if you already paid cumulatively till that month, already more than 1% means, then you need not pay anything in cash in that particular month. Yeah, even though your turnover or value of supply is more than 50,00,000, still this is applicable, guys. Clear? So I don't expect any question on all this because this calculations and all will be complicated in the exam. But normal calculation or examples which we discussed till now will be asked. Clear? But you should know this point because this point is excluded from this rule 86B. I repeat this point. Guys, at the end of any particular month, we need to check what is my cumulative output GST from the beginning of the year till that month. Okay. Compare that with whatever cash you have paid from the beginning of the year till that month. If that is already more than 1%, then in that month, you need not pay anything in cash. That is using electronic cash ledger. Clear? And this situation will arise only if your ITC is equal to or more than your output GST. If your ITC is less than your output GST, we know that the difference should be paid in cash and there is no option for it. Clear? So this situation, 86B rule, or the situation will arise only when your input tax credit is equal to your output GST or more than that. Clear, guys? Yes, sir. Chalo, last situation. Where the registered person is. So the registered person himself is government department or public sector undertaking, local authority or statutory body. So it is not like collecting my money from my own self, because government department, public sector undertaking, local authority, everything else belongs to government only. So here 1%, why they are collecting? Just because they don't have sufficient cash flow regularly throughout the year. Agree? So I cannot collect the cash from myself only, from me only. So that is why they have excluded this people also. That is government department, public sector undertaking, local authority and statutory body. However, the commissioner or an officer authorized by him in this behalf may remove the said restriction after such verification and such safeguard as he may deem fit. So this condition, whatever restrictions, everything is there, the commissioner will have an opportunity or right to remove these conditions or restrictions, whatever has been included in this rule 86B. Clear, guys? So if I just summarize this rule, it is applicable not for everyone, for only the supplier or registered person whose value of supply excluding two supply, zero rated supply and exempt supply, if it is more than 50 lakh in a month, in that month, this rule will be applicable. Fine, sir. What is the implication? What is the effect of this rule is, at least 1% of your output GST should be paid in cash. Or else, if I frame it in another way, whatever input tax credit you will utilize is should be maximum 99% of your output GST, which means at least 1% of your output GST should be paid in cash. That is using electronic credit ledger. Clear? Yes, sir. And few people have been excluded from this rule. That is, if the person has paid income tax of at least, means more than 1 lakh rupees in the last two previous years, or if you have got a refund of unutilized credit in case of zero rated supply or inverted duty structure of more than 1 lakh rupees in the last year, then even in that case, rule 86B is not applicable. Okay. The last two cases, that is, at the end of any particular month, if you have already paid more than 1% of your output GST as in cash or using electronic cash ledger, in that particular month, you need not pay anything in cash. You can utilize full credit, whatever is available with you. Fine. Lastly, it is also not applicable for government department, local authority, public sector undertaking and statutory authority or body. Yeah, easy. And sir, if by chance in the exam there is a question, they are not mentioned what is the value of supply of that particular person. In that case, assume the value of supply is less than 50 lakh because most of the situation or cases are not covered here, guys. Clear? Even government, when they announced that, they told only 0.5% of the suppliers are covered under this rule. Because who will have the value of supply more than 50 lakh in a month? Only the big players. Clear? So in your exam, if there is any question with respect to adjustment of credit, and if they have not mentioned the value of supply, don't consider rule 86B. Do the problem as we have done in our regular classes, and at the end, give a note. It is assumed that the value of that so-and-so person is not more than 50 lakh in that particular month. Clear? Clear, guys? So we are done with input tax credit chapter's amendments. Now we are going to the next chapter, that is chapter 7, registration. What are the amendments covered in this chapter? We would be doing it. Person or class of persons exempt from other authentication. This is an amendment which is covered in page number 96 in our regular study material. So come to our regular study material, page number 96, other authentication. Yes, this part. Sir, what is the provision covered here? It is actually covered in section 25, 6A, 6B, 6C, like that. What is covered is very simple. I will just explain. See, whenever you are registering under GST, other authentication is important. Sir, what is other authentication? You should give your other number. That is what the fancy net term they are using, other authentication. Sir, what if I don't have other number? Then before you get registration, they will physically verify your principal place of business. Clear? Only after that registration will be granted for you. Fine, sir. Sir, what if I already registered under GST? Because this other authentication things and all was brought down later. GST was implemented from 1st July 2017. So if you had already registered under GST before this provision, then you should get other authentication at least from after introduction of this provision. That is what they told. Sir, what if I don't have other? Again, same story. You have to get your principal place of business physically verified. Then only your registration will be valid, or else registration will be cancelled. this Aadhaar authentication is not applicable for few cases. What are those cases is covered here under section 25(6)(d). Clear? What is that? Just we will see it. Provision of sections 25(6)(b)(6)(c) shall not be applicable to a person who is not a citizen of India. Obviously, he cannot get Aadhaar. So for him, it is not applicable. Or else, class of person other than the following class of person. So for these people, for sure it is applicable. Agree? I repeat, class of person other than the following class of person, they are told. So they are not clearly mentioned for whom it is not applicable anta. But now they have mentioned it by way of amendment. So please look here. Section 625(6)(d) of CGST Act stipulates that the provisions relating to Aadhaar authentication shall not apply to such person or class of person or any state or union territory or part thereof as may be notified. And whatever is covered in our notes is this part. But this is removed now. So what has been replaced here is the above notification has now been superseded. So whatever we are learning now will supersede whatever was given before. Yes. And consequently, following persons have been exempted from Aadhaar authentication. So the following people need not get Aadhaar authentication. Straight away, they have given that these people need not get Aadhaar authentication. So who are those? A person who is not a citizen of India. This person was previously also covered. The other things are department or establishment of state government or central government, local authority, statutory body, public sector undertaking, a person applying for unique identification number. So these people need not get their Aadhaar authentication at the time of registration under GST, guys. Clear? So wherever possible, I am trying to connect to our regular study material. You guys need not take down anything. I told you I will be sharing this material with you. Wherever possible, make the changes in your regular study material only. And some things you cannot add completely. For example, rule 86B, can I add it in my regular study material? Not possible. It is lengthy. Okay. So those provisions study from this material only. Clear? Yes, sir. Next, we'll move to next amendment. Cancellation or suspension of registration, which is covered in section 29. Again, there is an amendment here, which is covered in page number 100 in our regular study material. Yeah, this point, page number 100 in our regular study material. Agree? So here, cancellation or suspension of registration. So in which all situation, the registration can be cancelled. There are two ways. Either assume I am a registered person, I can apply for cancellation of my registration because I don't want to do business, I don't want to carry my business, or else the proper officer, he himself, can cancel my registration. In which situation, under what circumstances was covered here? Agree? Under what circumstances it was covered here? Agree? For this, three more instances has been added now. Clear? Whatever was there, it will continue to be applied. In addition to this, three more conditions are there. What are those? We will see it here. So we are straight away going with 29(2). There is no change in 29(1), guys. So we are straight away going with 29(2). What is that? The proper officer may cancel. Proper officer means the GST officer may cancel the registration of a person from such date, including any of the retrospective date as he may deem fit, where in the following situation, the proper officer can cancel my registration. Which are those? A, B, C, D, E. Everything is same. Nothing change. F, G, H is a new conditions added. So only these things are new for you. That is why I have highlighted in red color. Wherever there is an amendment, I have just highlighted in red color so that it becomes easy for you guys to study. So these three are additional conditions. Avails ITC in violation of provisions of section 16 of CGST Act are the rules made thereunder. I have availed ITC, but I have violated section 16. So in 16, there are number of conditions that if I have to avail ITC, then I should be having invoice, I should have received goods, all those stories are there. I have violated that condition and I have taken ITC. In that case, my registration can be cancelled by the proper officer. Second one, violate the provision of rule 86B, new provision. I have violated that. And this is applicable only if rule 86B is applicable for me, because I can violate 86B if it is applicable for me. Sir, what if it is not applicable for me? Then this condition also will be not applicable for you. Okay. Then H, last condition, furnishes the details of outward supply in form GSTR 1 for one or more tax paid which is in excess of outward supplies declared by him in his valid return under section 39 for the said tax period. Sir, we have to, every normal taxpayers have to file two monthly returns, GSTR 1, 3B. One is with respect to what? Only outward supply. Sir, I have filed my GSTR 1 in which I have told my outward supply value is 10 lakh rupees. But by the time I file GSTR 3B within 20th of next month for the same month, I have showed that, sir, my value of outward supply is 12 lakh. So it is not matching. GSTR 1 is not matching with GSTR 3B. Agree? In that case also, your registration can be cancelled. Yeah? Yes, sir. So these are the three additional conditions added. Then before cancellation of registration, I will be given a reasonable opportunity of being heard. That means they will give a notice first telling your registration is getting cancelled under this grounds. Then you should explain, sir, why this story, means why you have violated so and so conditions and all. You will be given an opportunity to explain before the registration is cancelled. Clear? It is not a unilateral. First, you will be given an opportunity before the registration is cancelled. Then you have to explain yourself why you have done that, this and all. Then if still, if the proper officer feels that registration has to be cancelled, he will cancel it. Clear? Chalo. So here, in your regular study material, you can just add your refer amendment notes. Refer amendment notes. Because three additional points are there, which is given in amendment notes. All other things are same, guys. Okay, sir. And there is one more amendment with respect to this. The period and manner of suspension of registration is as follows. Here it is given. In the same page, here it is given. Yeah, after that table, it is given. The period and manner of suspension. Sir, what is the suspension? See, the proper officer is cancelling your registration. So there is some process going on. That is, he has given a notice for you. You have to respond for that notice. During this period, can you carry on the business? No, your business will be suspended. Your business will be suspended till your registration is completely cancelled. Agree? For example, assume today is 22nd September. The proper officer has identified that you are violated some provisions of income tax, GST. You have violated some of the provisions of GST. Assume input tax credit provisions you have violated. So immediately what I will do is I will suspend your registration. That means you cannot do any business during this period. Okay. And I will send a notice. I have not cancelled your registration. I have just suspended. Means I have just kept it on hold. Okay, sir. I will send a notice immediately for you telling, sir, I have observed that you have violated the ITC provision, that this and all the grounds I will mention, and send a notice. And I will wait for your response. After that only I can take a call with respect to cancellation or non-cancellation. So during this period, I will suspend your registration. And the old provision was telling, if you are cancelling the registration, who? The proper officer, if he is cancelling the registration, then first he has to give a reasonable opportunity. And even when I am suspending the registration also, I should give a reasonable opportunity for the registered person. But that point has been removed now. So after the amendment, it is like this. So in the first point, there is no amendment, guys. In the first point, there is no amendment. In the second point, there is an amendment. What is that? I have violated in the red color. Please observe. Where the cancellation of registration has been initiated by the department on its own motion. That means proper officer is cancelling the registration on his own motion. Where the proper officer has reasons to believe that the registration of a person is liable to be cancelled, he can now suspend the registration of such person pending the cancellation proceedings. Means cancellation proceedings is still pending. So I can suspend without offering the said person a reasonable opportunity of being heard. I will not ask him, why did you do this? what did you do, why did you do, what was the reason, I will not ask anything, immediately I will suspend. Cancellation, I will give you an opportunity for you. For suspension, no opportunity. With effect from the date to be determined by him, pending the completion of proceedings for cancellation of registration. One more additional point. In case where the cancellation is initiated by the department on its own, the registration of a person has been suspended, such person shall not be granted any refund. He will not be given any refund, even though he is eligible for unutilized credit for a refund of the CGST Act during the period of suspension of his registration. Previously, already 2 points were there. During the period of suspension, already 2 points were there. That is, I shall not make any taxable supply and I shall not be required to furnish any return. These 2 points were already there. Now, one more point they have added here is, you cannot take any refund during your suspension period, which is an amendment. Clear? So, whatever I have violated here in red color is an amendment, guys. All other things is same provision. Clear? So, here, for second point, you can write, refer amendment notes. Refer amendment notes. Because here you can observe, after affording the said person a reasonable opportunity of being heard is there, na? Now it has been removed. We are not giving any opportunity for the registered person before we suspend the registration. When I'm cancelling, I will give an opportunity. But while suspending, no opportunity is given. Here, yeah, please understand the difference. Yes, sir. Shalom. Next, one more very big amendment. What is that? We will see. Revised time limit prescribed under Rule 9, Amendment, page number 103 in your regular study material. What is this? Please look here. Please look here. I will explain. See, when a person should apply for registration, whenever my aggregate turnover crosses 10 lakh, 20 lakh, 40 lakh, all those limits are there. Agree? When my aggregate turnover crosses that limit, I have to apply for registration within 30 days. Agree? Yes, sir. I have applied for registration. Yes, in REG 1. Within 3 days, old provision I am telling, within 3 days, my proper officer should accept my application and he has to issue the registration certificate. Agree, na? But that 3 days now has been replaced with 7 days. So if I go to our regular study material, come to this part, see here, it was within 3 days. Just make 7 days then. So now 3 has been replaced with 7. In this summary of forms, page number 103. Then here also, come to this form, GST REG 6. Here also within 3 days is there, na? Make this 3, 7. Make this 3, 7. So after this amendment, what is the effect? I will tell. Please pay attention. Please pay attention here. Sir, I will apply for registration in REG 1. Within 7 days, the proper officer either should accept my application or else he should give a notice for me. If he is not satisfied with whatever information I have given in the REG 1, he will give a notice for me, telling, give some more additional information or explain this, explain that, he will give a notice. And for that notice, I have to respond within 7 days. And by the time I respond for that notice, within 7 days, he should again issue the certificate for me. That is registration certificate. Clear? That is what the change here. So even in my revision notes, here I would have mentioned within 3 days. Agree? So now it is 7 days. So from the date I apply for registration, within 7 days, either my application should be accepted or rejected. Or rejected means he will give a notice for you. Please explain so and so additional things I need, or why is this so, all that notice he will give. And for that notice, I have to reply within 7 days. And once I reply for that notice, within 7 days, it should be accepted. It should be accepted by whom? The proper officer. That is what is given. See, here, this is also a change. If the proper officer does not take any action within 7 days of submission of application, along with the necessary details and documents, or within 7 days of receiving the clarification so solicited, the application of grant of registration is deemed to be approved. I told you, sir, once I apply for registration, within 7 days, it should be either accepted or he has to give a notice. But proper officer has not done anything. Already 8th day is done, 9th day is done. I am in 10th day. So what is this understood? By the end of 7th day, it is understood that my registration is granted. Yeah, that is what is given. Even this is a change. Just a second. It is covered here. Please make a change. It is mentioned somewhere here. Section. Yeah, come to this. Section 25. Procedure for registration. Here within 3 days is mentioned. Make it 7. Make it 7. This is under section 25. Page number someone quickly. 94. Page number 94. Please make 3 as 7, guys. So this is a very small change. Yeah, you can update this in the regular notes itself. Okay. Clear? Any doubt with respect to this? Hope everything is clear. Then going to the next chapter, guys. So we are done with 2 chapters. Another 2 chapters are left with respect to amendments. Amendments are given with respect to 4 chapters totally. So we are now into 3rd chapter. That is chapter 8. Amendments 3rd chapter. But in our syllabus, it is chapter 8. Which is that chapter? Tax invoice, credit note and debit note. What is this? We will see. First amendment in this chapter. E-invoicing mandatory for all registered businesses with aggregate turnover in any preceding financial year from 17-18 onwards greater than 50 crore. Same provision was there, but the limit was different previously. So what is that amendment? It is covered in page number 112 in your regular study material. With effect from 1st October 2020, all registered business with an aggregate turnover based on PAN in the preceding financial year from 17-18 onwards greater than 500 crore were required to mandatorily issue e-invoices for all B2B invoices. That is business to business. That is from registered person to registered person if there is any supply. And if my aggregate turnover was more than 500 crore in a year, in any year from 17 to 18, then I should file my invoices electronically only. That is, I should issue my invoices electronic form only. But now this 500 crore limit has been reduced. That is an amendment. So in our study material, whatever we have covered is 500 crore. Now there has been a change. With effect from 1st January 2021, e-invoicing has been made mandatory. Don't make any changes in your regular study material, I will tell, because there are 2 changes here. Which one to update? So please don't make any change. With effect from 1st January 2021, e-invoicing has been made mandatory for all the registered businesses with an aggregate turnover in any preceding financial year from 17-18 greater than 100 crore. So if your aggregate turnover is 100 crore or more in any previous year from 17-18, then for you e-invoicing is mandatory. But further, again, this limit is reduced. Further, the threshold limit for mandatory issuing e-invoicing is 50 crore with effect from 1st April 21. So as on today, what is the limit? 50 crore. Clear? So as on today, if by chance, if they don't mention any dates in the question and all, the limit applicable is 50 crore. If by chance, if they mention the date, then the limits will play a major role. Clear? So I have also given a table here. So e-invoicing is mandatory for every taxpayer whose aggregate turnover in any financial year from 17-18 exceeds 500 crore means it was from 1st October 2020. 500 crore was added from 1st October. But now from 1st January, they reduced it to 100 crores. So from 1st January, any registered person, if their aggregate turnover in any past year is more than 100 crore means for them, e-invoicing is mandatory. And from 1st April 2021, they reduced this limit to 50 crore. So in this case, if in any previous years, if your aggregate turnover is more than 50 crore, then e-invoicing is mandatory for you. Yeah. So in simple, as of now, who should do e-invoicing means those aggregate turnover in any past year is more than 50 crore. Clear? So from 1st April 21, this is the situation. Clear? So in your regular study material, come to the chapter. How much was the page number? 112. Come to page number 112. Yeah, year. So this has been cancelled, 500 crore. And here you don't write any changes. Better write refer amendment note. Refer amendment notes you write. Because there are two limits now. Which one will you write here? And dates are also is there. Answer is date important? Yes. In this case, as there are two changes updated, date is important, guys. Try to remember. So from 1st January, 100 crore. From 1st April, 50 crore. April is which month? For after 3 months. So 50% of that they have taken it. Yeah. So try to remember like that with a shortcut. Chalo guys. And 500 will not have any impact for your exam. Forget about it. 500 should I remember, sir? No. So remember 100 when, 50 when. That's all. Okay. We have covered this amendment also. Oof. Yes, guys. Next one. Validity period of e-way bill or consolidated e-way bill reduced, rule 138.10, amendment, page number 111. So same chapter, come to page number 111 for this table. For this table, you can update the changes here only. So here the validity period of e-way bill was covered. Agree means for how long the e-way bill is valid. Up to 100 kilometers, it was 1 day. And over and above 100 kilometers, for every 100 kilometer, it was one more day. Agree? So now this has been made 200 kilometer. And for every 200 kilometer or part thereof, over and above 200 kilometers, it is 1 day. So everywhere 100 is replaced with 200 now. Please make a note of the amendment in your regular study material only. 100 is replaced with 200 now. Chalo, let us see what is that amendment. Rule 138.10 elaborates the validity period of e-way bill or consolidated e-way bill with effect from, again, the changes brought from when? 1st January. Maximum changes or amendments are from 1st January. Whatever amendments we are covering today. Validity period of e-way bill or consolidated e-way bill has been reduced as follows. Previously, it was up to 100 kilometer, but after amendment, it is up to 200 kilometer. Okay. What is the validity period? 1 day in case, same story. 1 day and all is same. So I'm not reading it. Then coming to second scenario, it was 100 kilometer again here. For every 200 kilometer or part thereof, thereafter, it is one more additional day. Sir, what is the effect of this? Let me see it. Sir, assume I have generated e-way bill today. That is 22nd September. And I have generated a e-way bill to travel from Karnataka to Andhra, some place whose distance is 500 kilometer. Now tell me, e-way bill validity period is for how many days? It is whatever e-way bill I have generated on 22nd September is valid for how many days? For every 200 kilometer, 1 day. Agree. So for every 200 kilometer, 1 day, or part of 200 kilometer also 1 day. So totally three days I can tell. I repeat, for every 200 kilometer, 1 day, and over and about 200 kilometer, for every 200 kilometer or part of 200 kilometer, one more additional day. So for first 200 kilometer, 1 day, for next 200 kilometer, 2 days. So totally 2 days, plus for remaining 100 kilometers, don't give half day, again 1 day only. Yeah, don't calculate proportionate. For 200 kilometer, 1 day means how much hours per 100 kilometers, how much hours per 10 kilometers. Even if it is a 10 kilometer, for example, assume 420 kilometers. So what will be the validity period? Still 3 days only. Still 3 days. Part of 200 or exactly 200 will be 1 day validity period, guys. Okay, this was an amendment. So here also one example I have given. A registered person has to transport the goods from its warehouse in its depot located at a distance of 500 km or 500 km only. In this case, the e-way bill generated is valid for 3 days. Clear? Again, this is only an amendment. I have made you guys to amend in my regular study material only. Chalo. Next one. Blocking of e-way bill generation facility. See, whatever e-way bill I can generate for the transportation of goods normally from one place to another place, it is blocked for few people. It is blocked for few people means you cannot generate. You cannot generate e-way bill with your GST identification number. So what are those situations? Three situations are covered. Please, you have to refer, means you have to study it from this material only. What is that? We will see. Blocking of e-way bill generation facility 138E. Blocking of e-way bill generation facility means disabling a taxpayer from generating the e-way bill. A user will not be able to generate e-way bill for a GST identification number if the said GST identification number is not eligible for e-way bill generation as per rule 138E of CGST rules. The GST identification number of such blocked taxpayers cannot be used to generate e-way bill either as a consigner or consignee. If my GST identification number is nothing but GST registration number, if that number is blocked for the generation of e-way bill, I cannot generate e-way bill. Sir, in which situation my GST identification number will be blocked to generate e-way bill is in these three situations. What are those situations? We will see. First one. In case if I am a composition person who is covered under section 10, if I don't file the statement in form CMP-8 for 2 consecutive quarters, if I am a composition person and if I don't file the statement, not the written, payment statement, GST CMP-8 for 2 consecutive quarters, then I will not be able to generate e-way bill. First scenario. Second one. A person paying the tax under regular scheme, that is normal scheme, section 9, has not furnished the returns for a consecutive period of 2 tax period. 2 tax period means if you are filing monthly, then 2 months. If you are paying the taxes, you also have an option to pay taxes quarterly. So in that case, quarterly. Clear? Yes, sir. So second point is for regular tax person. Third point. A person whose registration has been suspended under rule 21A pending the completion of proceedings for cancellation of registration. So we learned when the registration can be suspended. When your registration is suspended also, your GST registration will still be there, but you cannot generate e-way bill. Clear? So in these three situations, the registered person, even though his registration is effective, even though he has GST identification number, he still cannot generate e-way bill. Yeah, please do study this, that is rule 138E from the amendment material only. Next, the last new clarification which has been given, when some clarification is given with respect to dynamic quick response code. What is that? We will see. This is the last amendment in this chapter. Clarification in respect of applicability of dynamic quick response code. Sir, what is quick response code? You know, na? Google Pay, Phone Pay and all you do, QR code. Same thing. So who should have this and when should they have, how should they have, everything has been explained and clarified here. All B2C invoices, that is business to consumers, that is registered person to unregistered person. C is nothing but consumers, whom we call it as unregistered person. Yeah. For example, I am registered under GST. No, sir. If I go and buy anything, obviously I am not eligible to claim any ITC. So still, the supplier should have a QR code for the payment. When? We will see it here. All B2C invoices issued by a registered person whose aggregate turnover in any preceding financial year from 17-18 onwards exceeds 500 crores are mandatorily required to have QR code from December 1st, 2020. So the cutoff date to have QR code is 1st December 2020. To know whether I should have QR code or not, go to your past and see. In any of your previous year, if your aggregate turnover in any year is more than 500 crore means, then I should have QR code even though if I am selling anything to the consumers or unregistered person. Why? Sir, what is the logic behind this? Because see, when I am selling something for an unregistered person. Will I give a bill? Normally, I don't give because even the supplier recipient is not bothered about it because you don't claim credit. Why do you want a bill? Obviously, you will not demand for a bill. So in that situation, there is a chance that I may not disclose this turnover or this supply. Agree? So to avoid this, to route this through my bank, they're telling you should have QR code for your business. So that at least when the payment is made, it is credited to your bank account immediately, the department will catch. Resultantly, it has been notified that invoice issued by a registered person except specified class of persons discussed below, whose aggregate turnover in a financial year exceeds 500 crore in repo in respect of B2C, that is business to consumer supply, that is supply of goods or services or both, to an unregistered person shall have dynamic QR code. Sir, 500 is 500 only, still 500 only. It has not been changed. Previously, we discussed 500 has been reduced to 100, 100 reduced to 50. Here, 500 remains 500 only. Yes, sir. What is that? And they have told that it is applicable for registered person except specified class of person. That is, for some specified class of person, this is not applicable, it seems. Even though their turnover is more than 500 crore. Who are those some special person? We will see. Yes, sir. Fine, we shall continue. Now, this QR code requirement is not applicable for few people. Who are those? We will see. Non-applicability of requirement of dynamic QR code. Dynamic QR code is not applicable to an invoice issued to an unregistered person by the following suppliers. So, for the following suppliers, QR code requirement is not applicable even though their aggregate turnover is more than 500. Yeah. So irrespective of their aggregate turnover, for the following suppliers, QR code requirement is not applicable. Who are those? Insurer or banking company or financial institution, including NBFC. Then goods transport agency supplying services in relation to transportation of goods by road in a goods carriage. Then supplier of passenger transportation service like KSRTC, BMTC and all. Then person supplying services by way of admission or exhibition of cinematograph films in multiplex screens. That is INOX, PVR and all. Then supplier of online information and database access or retrieval services. In short, OID or OIDAR services. Clear? So in the following cases, the supplier need not have the QR code for payment. Fine. Next, no dynamic QR code in case of export. As regards the supplies made for export, those supplies are made by a registered person to an unregistered person. So assume I am an exporter, I am making some supply from India to Singapore for an unregistered person. Obviously that person will not be registered in India. Okay, so I am making a supply to unregistered person. However, since e-invoices are required to be issued in respect of supplies for exports, treating them as B2B supplies. So in case of export supply, e-invoicing is mandatory. Even though the recipient is not registered, we have to assume that he is registered and e-invoice is mandatory. E-invoice is mandatory and dynamic QR code requirement will not be applicable to them because I cannot ask him to come and scan my code and pay in India. Okay, yes, online also you can do an arrangement, but this QR code arrangement is not applicable for an exporter, even though his turnover is more than or less than 500 crore. Okay, sir. Next, third point. Parameters details are required to be captured in a dynamic QR code. What are the information which should be captured in the QR code? Dynamic QR code inter alia shall contain the following information. What is inter alia? Some of the points we have given. This is not the conclusive list. This is not the ultimate list. Inter alia means some of the points we have given, which is important. Supplier GST identification number. Then supplier UPI ID. Pay is bank account number and IFSC. Pay means again supplier only. Who is receiving the payment? Obviously, supplier only will be receiving the payment. Sometimes, why they have used the word pay here is sometimes business might be registered in someone's name. Bank account, I might be using some other name. Okay. In that case, pay is bank account number and IFSC should be given. Then invoice number and invoice date. Total invoice value and that is the value of supply. Then GST amount along with the breakup of how much is CGST, SGST, IGST and CESS, etc. Further, dynamic QR code should be such that it can be scanned to make digital payment. So whatever QR code you have, just for the purpose of having it as a provision, you should not have it. I should be able to make a payment from that QR code. Clear? Yes, sir. So we are done with the amendments with respect to three chapters, guys. So one more chapter is left, which is a headache chapter. Means there are a lot of changes which has been brought down in this chapter, which we will do tomorrow. Clear, guys? So we have covered the amendments with respect to three chapters. As I already told you guys, I have prepared a separate material for you. Whatever I am discussing now is from a separate material. So I will share this material once I complete the amendments tomorrow with you. You guys can keep it as a reference. I have prepared this material just to connect with my regular study material so that it will be easy for your reference and study. And most of the amendments I have already made you people to mark it in the regular study material only. Yeah. And for some amendments, wherever it is not possible to adjust in regular study material, please do refer this amendment notes only. And this amendment notes, from where did I prepare? By keeping the statutory update of the institute as a reference, guys. Clear? So here I have tried to simplify all those things and try to connect to my regular study material so that it will become easy for your study. Clear, guys? Yes, sir.